says, oh, my lads, you should have seen him running. Asked them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses smiled upon their faces, walking down the valley road to see the burned in aces. You should have seen them running. Ask them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the Manny Road to see the burned in aces. Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Ask them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, we're walking down the Manny Road to see the burned in aces.
Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Hello everybody, welcome to our stream. Great to see you all again. We've stuck a poll up in the groups. If you'd kindly vote on that and leave your comments what you think, what you'd like to see, etc., we'd really appreciate it. The streams are going brilliant now. But apparently, if you like and subscribe on YouTube, we'll start getting a few quid, which will all go, you know what we're all about, helping our own. So if you could do that, that'd be fantastic. Couple of sad announcements. We lost one of the Dean Whites last week, a guy by the name of Mr. Paul Settle. Fantastic bloke, and he just absolutely loved football. So we'd like to pass our love, respect, and condolences on to Paul's family and friends. And also yesterday, we laid to rest John Christopher Hall. I think he's an Ashley Bridge lad. If he's not, I apologise. But same again to John's family and friends. God bless you and sleep tight. Admin is still suffering from COVID. He's not very well at all. So if you could all send him some well wishes via a message to Aggie, we'd appreciate that. Thanks very much. Right, I'll hand you over to Twiggy, and he can let you know the crack with tonight's sponsor. Thanks.
Hi, guys. Welcome again. We've got a great lad on tonight, Mike Whitlow, proper true legend of Bolton. Just before I just announce the this week's sponsor, just want to give me on tribute to Paul Settle. Lost him last week. Great shock over Dean. Used to love great chats with him about football. Loved it. Like I say, so shocked when we heard the sad news. Love and condolences go out to the family, Lou, and obviously mum and brother. Yeah, thinking of you all. Okay, this week's live stream sponsored by Andy Morrill, Oscar Recruitment, with the recruitment consultancy for IT and tech design. Offices worldwide. Andy, he's told me that the CEO is a mad Bolton fan. So that's good to hear. Next week's stream is Saturday night again, and we've got Robbie Savage on there. Again, if anybody wants wants to sponsor any of the streams, give me a shout and we'll sort that out. Okay, I'll pass you over to Al now.
All right, thanks, James. Okay, the moment you're on my way, I've been speaking to this fella this week, and I'll tell you what, he's an absolute star. Another 100%er who, to be honest, when he was in our team, he never got the accolades that he actually deserves. So here he is. Please welcome Mr. Mike Whitlow. Hi, Mike.
Evening. Good to see you all. Welcome.
Spot on. Right, we'll go through a few questions. How's life treating you at the moment?
Yeah, I'm very fortunate that I get outside a lot because we're still coaching. I'm coaching now, so a lot plenty of fresh air and, you know, staying safe and well, washing lots of bibs, cleaning lots of footballs and doing a lot of cleaning and cooking, but it's all good, thank you.
Brilliant, mate. Great to see you anyway, and as I say, welcome to the stream. We've got had lots of good comments about you, and you're still well thought of in the town. So let's go through a few things. Start with your stats. Obviously, you started at Bolton, didn't you?
Yeah, I received a scholarship. It all really started before that. You've got a few ugly mugs coming up in a bit, but when I was younger, my old man was a goalkeeper, so I always wanted to be a goalkeeper.
Really?
Yeah, and until 14, a school teacher thought I was quick, so he'll chuck me up front. I was always in goal because I wanted to follow Dad. Being a goalie. So I went as a centre forward, come whatever you do, just chase the ball up front. And within the year of being there, Mid Cheshire Boys gave me the opportunity from school. And then Bolton took me as a left winger centre forward.
Well, never knew that. But anyway, you moved on then, didn't you? These are some of the pictures that you just referred to. What's that one?
That's where I could not pull my shorts up any higher to my chest. Seriously, when I saw this, I'm thinking, what are you doing? This is proper old school, isn't it?
You look like Simon Cowell on that.
Oh, believe me. Did myself, there's worse pictures coming, and you know this, without Barney. But this was my first where I got selected Mid Cheshire Boys under 15s.
I believe you used to play for with another one of our legends, Mark Cairn's son, for that team. Is that right?
Yeah, bless him. I can't figure out in there, because I think he was a year after that, because I remember Dave, because he was a bit like Matt, but blonder.
Right.
He was decent, to be fair to him. And yeah. If you'd have asked him then if I was going to be a tackling, edit, kick it, grow, he'd have probably laughed. I was a little fella up front that used to just chase things. And if you said that, I'd have probably ducked.
He actually said that you used to play well above your level there. He said you were head and shoulders above the rest of them, like David.
Well, bless him, it was kind, but I'll go back when we had a young lad called, I used to think, wow, when I was playing in this team, and he's not in this picture, but he was the same age, and he went to Everton, and bless him, he only got, I think, to a first-year pro level, but he was a million times better. A lad called Jason Danskin, and that come from the area where Mark and that is in Winsford, and he was, wow, his feet were ridiculous. And I used to think, out of all of us, he was going to be the one. And he progressed to, with Everton, to, I think it was 19. And then I think he fell out of it and went into non-league and things. But in that group, he was, for me, was by far the best player.
Wow.
But that, if David was very kind. Very kind. Nice comments.
Let's just put this on the... a bigger screen.
Oh,
here we go.
This is where I'm at the moment. This is the trophy that they're holding at the moment. This was last year's under 18s that we worked with at Mansfield, and they come with us on a 2-year scholarship. And the trophy is actually played for. We lost a physio, so Notts County. He worked for Notts County, and he worked at Mansfield. And he had a big part in setting Mansfield Academy up 5 years ago. But bless him, he got cancer. At 25, we lost him.
Oh, no. So
both clubs, whenever we play now, play for the Matt Salmon Trophy. And these lads understand, because some of these lads had been through and met Matt. So sometimes it puts things in perspective.
Yeah.
At 25, these lads are getting an opportunity of playing football every day. But they're a cracking group, I must admit.
Superb that. Right, there's a Mr. Whitlock. That one with some pretty good names on. Joyce is on, and Sam Allardyce and Mark Winstanley.
Yeah, I always kept these because when I went back all them years ago, I'd said I'd played alongside him and he had to look after me, bless, and then he was managing me. And yeah, I was very fortunate that we spoke today about this. Mark came, bless him, like we spoke, used to pick me up, take me, drop me off. I stayed in digs for a while. And if I'm honest, when I got released, when you look back, it was probably the best thing that happened to me and the most honest thing that made me realise that, did I really do enough? Probably not, you know, at the time. I was centre forward, did okay. Neil come with Steve Carroll, was, bless him, then the youth team. I'd had an operation on bunions on my feet. Mark was running around, nicking all my money for petrol, as we spoke about. Didn't buy me a bacon butty ever. So I remember that one. But no, they were brilliant with me. And when it come to making a decision, he just said, listen, your attitude and your work and stuff, you know, it's been rubbish over the last 3 months. And if he's being honest, he was right. But at the time, yeah, I was 18, cried, went home, spat me dummy out, and went working in ICI with John Bishop, the comedian, Eddie Bishop, his brother that was at Northwich Vicks at the time. And I went working in a pneumonia, cleaning pneumonia tanks out for a little while. And that brought home that this is a proper job and a proper world. You know, not playing football every day. And I didn't want to play it, if I'm being honest. My dad went mad. My dad went mad at me because, yeah, I did spit my dummy out for probably about a season. I don't think I played for a season. And then we go back to my dad and a bloke in the street called, and said, how do you fancy playing? And I'm like, nah. I kept saying no. And then, come on, come and play. And it was a team that was just from the local village in Lostock. So I turned up, and that season we won two cups of league, and I got 61 goals in 2010.
Wow.
And the crazy mad thing was that some of the lads then said, you know, Witten, why don't you come and have a look at Witten? They had a link with the builder's yard, which meant I'd get the time off if I needed it. For the games, and I'd get some money. They'd pay me car insurance, which was like Christmas. You know, it was weird because I started as a sort of forward come left winger, and then Stan Allen and John Davison, somebody got hurt, Russ out, and it was Ginger, left back, got hurt one night, and go to left back, and 3 months later, and I'm signing for Leeds, which was crazy because I've never tackled anybody in my life. But you'd never thought that.
Yeah, and here you are with there's some absolute legends on there, aren't there? There really is. I believe I were reading something up about you didn't get your medal for 10 years or something like that when you won the first, which would be the Premier League. No, obviously, when you won First Division Championship, you didn't get your medal for another 10 years. Is that right?
Yeah, well, it sounds crazy. We'd won League Two, so I was fortunate to be involved in that, winning the league with them in League Two then. And then we went up and I played the season. And then the season after, Tony DiRigo come. And let's talk truth, Mike Whitlow, Tony DiRigo, left back. Tony was playing for England, absolute legend. I thought, well, I'm not going to play that much. So I had a chat with Howard. Howard was brilliant. And I said, listen, I just want to play football. He said, oh, what, you stay, be part of the squad. I says, but I'm not going to play. Mel Sterling, England, one side. Tony DiRigo, England, left back, the other side. I'm going to be a really good sub. You know? And I wanted Saturdays were for playing football. So I asked Steve, and he said, do I want to put a circular around and if anybody would show interest? And, yeah, Brian Little come in and off a toddled, and yeah, I had a fantastic time there. You know, I was in the changing room, and you look round and you've got Chrissy Fairclough. Oh my God, who did that haircut, by the way? They're getting worse, aren't they?
Well, no, that's all right, that one.
This must have been how far I can flick my head across from one side. I'm so glad it's gone like this and I have to shave it, you know. I don't know what was going on.
Brilliant.
But no, I had some unbelievable times, because this is where people like Mervyn Day, the goalkeeper, Noel Blake, they took the time out to make sure that I was okay, because I was a youngster. Because I signed for Leeds on the Monday, went back home, got me stuff, trained on the Tuesday, made my Simod Cup debut against, I think it's Simod Cup debut midweek, I think it was Shrewsbury. And then 10 days later, because he hadn't had a fixture, Glyn Snodden had gone down with glandular fever. So they put the team up, and I made my league debut in front of 40,000 against Stoke.
Excellent.
In the case of a week, I'd gone from playing Sunday with my dad and my mates to playing for Leeds, and it was madness. It was wonderful, yeah. I must admit.
What was, there were some massive characters in that team. What was Gordon Strachan like?
Legend. Total respect. Seriously, everything he did was immaculate, and he led by example.
Yeah.
The one thing he would do, he was fiery. He would come after you. If your standards weren't, and you weren't giving everything, he would tell you. But he led by example. And I must admit, how he was off the field with me, it was wonderful. I'll never forget my time with, as I say, there was a few of them at Leeds that were, I was a young lad at the time, and they looked after me at Treat. And yeah, what a captain he was.
Good. And then how did this move come about? Did they come in for you, or did you just go in and say, what was the story behind moving to Leicester?
Yeah, we just had a chat, like we said, because I knew I wasn't going to play and I wanted to play football. They brought me. Mick Hennigan had seen me while watching the right back, scouted. They took me in. Originally, we went to Sheffield Wednesday with Howard and Mick for a week, but he was going to Leeds, walked out and went to Leeds, and Peter Eustace looked after us. He said he'd keep in touch. We went to there. I said to Howard, listen, you've been great. I've been here a while now, but, you know, I want to play football. I'm still learning. This was, God, cut me in half. I just want to get on a Saturday and play football. Brian Little come in and went and had a chat with him, and the rest was history. Off I went, packed my bags, and off you go like a little gypsy, find a house and carry on playing football.
How long was Brian Little there for? Because all the success with Martin O'Neill, didn't it?
Well, sort of, because like Brian had done the playoffs. We'd done a few playoffs and he tried to get us up. And then between Brian and Martin, there was Mark McGee who come in, and then he went to Wolves. But no, we had some good times, I must admit, with Brian. We were close. I said to you before, I don't know if it was a lucky omen or unlucky omen, because I did four playoff finals with them. But the first two we lost, and then the next two we won. So it was good times at the time, as in I could never imagine moving from Leeds, going to Leicester and playing at Wembley against Blackburn with Kenny Dalglish's manager at the end of the season in a playoff final. Because Wembley's like the sacred ground, the old Wembley with the Twin Towers, and God, what's that about? What am I doing there? It's crazy.
Absolutely. You actually hold a record, don't you, that's never been broken for playoffs?
I think I've played in a few, far too many, but it's been fun. I've done all the semi-finals with Leicester and all the finals, and then I had a couple more with Bolton, to be fair.
So, yeah, I think it was 12 semi-finals and finals, weren't it, altogether?
Altogether, I think 12 games, yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, I've got a bit of footage here I'm going to play. I put a compilation together. You'll have to forgive me for the first goal, though.
Oh, okay, probably.
Well, that's going to work out well for Derby. Great run by Sturridge. Sturridge into the box. And Whitlow's put through his own net. 2-0. that could...
Oh, and Walsh has missed it, and it's in, Whitlow. The goalkeeper didn't make it.
Serious injury is about to lift a trophy for only the second time in the history of his beloved Leicester City. Leicester City win the season's first major honour of Coca-Cola.
So what's your memory of that, Mike?
The interesting thing about the great finish, by the way, won it. Wrong goal.
Yeah, against them.
No, I must admit, the Coca-Cola final was special because I'd been out for 6 weeks and I'd had a hernia and I needed an operation. And there was myself and a Swedish international called Pontus K-Mark. And we'd both been out. And it was a Coca-Cola final, and Steve Guppy and a couple of others were cup-tied. So what happened was, it said to us, listen, I'm going to play you. I need you fit. So for 2 solid weeks, me and Pontus worked and worked, and they kept us out, afternoons, mornings. It come to the week of the game and threw us in.
Really?
We played in the final, but then after the final, because we drew, the first game was drawn, so we had to go to Hillsborough for the replay. So we went to Hillsborough. We didn't. Me and Pontus didn't play again till the replay because Steve Guppy played in the league games as a wing back. And then when it comes to the cup final, he puts both back in again. It was brilliant.
Wow.
So yeah, it was unbelievable. And yeah, the goal was something to behold. And you know, we were lucky with Claridge was the scruffiest little urchin you've ever met. But what a team player, honestly. He could run forever. Honestly, forever.
How did you feel when you scored that goal against the intruder noisy neighbours then?
I must admit, I've got two special memories, and that's one of them, out of football. Yeah. Because I said to you, my friends are United or City fans. We lived up the road. We used to jump on a train and either go in the Stretford End or the Kippax. And my mates were in there. I won't repeat what they said to me, but I was thinking I was on. There was me and Stuart Pearce that year that scored against United at Old Trafford. I think one was an own goal, and me and Pearce were. They conceded 3 goals at Old Trafford that year.
Wow!
So it was a banger as well, wasn't it? You don't get many like that.
Oh well, we all enjoyed it. We all enjoyed it, didn't we?
Oh yeah.
So, it looks like he's just about to fill his mouth for him there.
Yeah.
It was interesting. Yeah. We played Middlesbrough.
Yeah.
And the thing with it was he was a legend. No ifs and buts about it, an absolute legend. And I thought, mentally, if I get into him, I've got him. Because his feet were ridiculous. And so I followed him, I kicked him, I chased him. And yeah, and once it's a bit grey, you think, yeah, I'm all right now. Because he's punching bells at me instead of thinking about scoring a goal. But no, he's a great player. And I've said this before, I'm daft as a brush, but when I went on a football field, I wanted to win. And
yeah,
no wrong with that.
And it's a favourite one. I've got one somewhere with Shearer, and he was a legend. He absolutely mugged me off every time we played them because he could play you a treat. And but these were internationals and special, and so it was special memories.
What was Martin O'Neill like to work for?
Martin, when you first come in at half time and at the end of the game, just sit down, have a cup of tea, and don't even listen to him. Sounds crazy. That was my because he's still in the game. He's the most passionate man you've ever met.
Really?
When he first comes in, but he's still in the game. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
He's still there. So sometimes it's just like it's learning about people and learning to know. But, oh yeah, he's special. You know, let's be fair. He did wonders, and the way he goes, and he had his staff with him. He looks after John Robertson. I think he still does now wherever he goes, who used to come out on a Friday with the biggest leg brace you've ever seen. This was a legend that played for Forest on the wing.
Yeah.
He couldn't walk hardly. He'd come out on a Friday and join in oldies, youngies, five aside. Never gave the ball away, but he couldn't run. And you couldn't get it off him. Sometimes you look and you think, wow, I wonder what he was really, really like every day in training when he was at his peak. But Martin was brilliant. I must admit, really? Martin, he wonderful. He really did.
Right, so just going through your ex-clubs here, and we'll get to the best last. Sheffield United for a short time, but this is, it's kind of where your coaching career started, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, Neil Warnock took me there. I was an elder statesman, as they say, getting into future years, and there was no way I was going to be playing Saturday, Tuesday. So I played alongside the Jaggy Elker or Chris Morgan or, you know, Robert Page, who was there. And then, yeah, Ronnie Reed, who was there at the time, was an absolute legend with me. Because, you know, I was staying over there, sometimes he'd say, you know, come and work with kids. And the crazy thing, I'm showing my age now, the kids back then were Billy Sharp, Michael Tong, Jonathan Forte. You can go through it, Nick Montgomery. They all went on. There was about 8 or 9 of them that went through that group into professionals. And I'd turn up and run it. I'd say, what are we doing? He went, here you go, the yours. And I'm like, well, what am I doing? He went, what do you want? I was like, well, you give them a ball, and they were unbelievable anyway. And I just, it sounds crazy because it was exciting and their enthusiasm and they wanted to learn and just what, it sounds crazy. No airs, no graces, just wanted to play football.
Yeah.
There was no issues with not being picked. There was no issues with the manager don't like me. All he wanted to do was play football. And, yeah, it was brilliant, honestly, I must admit. And that set me on my road. And I'll always be grateful to Ronnie. And then the last club I went to, there was a bloke called Steve Spooner. You know, I was having injections, if I'm being honest, in a back. I woke up one morning and couldn't stand up straight. Thought, that's me done. I know where I am mentally. If I keep doing this, I'm going to be a wreck.
We're talking about Notts County here, aren't we?
Yeah, at Notts. Because, you know yourself. My body was battered and it was time. So I called it time, and there was a bloke called Steve Spooner there. And I went working with him with the 18s. I'd sort of got a player coach one with the Biggins, but I couldn't deal with Biggins. To this day, I still find it difficult because I don't get why you can't give everything doing the best job that you love without moaning. Because the manager can only pick 11. If you're not in the team, work harder to get in the team and be respectful of the people that are in the team because you're trying to take the place. You've got to keep working. But I found that when I first come out of it, difficult, where when you work with the younger ones, they just want to learn and play. And if you can help them and guide them, not only, not being funny, to be a footballer, how many are really going to make it? You've got to be good people and make sure they do the best, try the hardest, so if they're not going to be a footballer, they might tie that into another job.
Yeah.
You know, nowadays you can go to America, you can go into sports therapy, you can do sports degrees, you can, there's that many opportunities. So that's why I work with the people.
Do you know what it is, Mike? It comes up every week, this, but I mean, pretty much just after your era and the crazy money coming to football, the players' mentality totally changed. They didn't play for the shirt. They kind of played for the play for the coin, didn't they? Do you think I'm right there or wrong?
The real ones, no. The real ones will always have a passion. It wouldn't matter how much you pay. The ones that, I don't know how many there is that have people playing on a Saturday, I just can't get my head now. Because football, or a Tuesday or whenever, every time you get an opportunity to put a football shirt on and play football, it's a dream. It's an opportunity to go and do something, I think, that you love. And if you love it, you try your best. So, you know, it's mad. If you come to me and said, £100 play against Man United next week, I wouldn't care if the other bloke was on £3 million.
Exactly.
And I think there's still a lot out there. But the thing is, because it's been thrown out with all the monies, sometimes it makes it seem like that, that some of them. It's difficult because I was never driven by money, I must admit, and never to this day, and never will.
God.
Superb.
Right, we're on to the one and only Wanderers now. So this is what all the lads have been playing about. And
now this gets worse, doesn't it? Because we started with a dodgy haircut. Now this looks like someone's put a wig on my head.
some proper players on there. Who signed you? I know it was, I think it was around £500,000 you signed for us, Paul, weren't it?
But it was Colin Todd.
Right.
Originally, I got a phone call. I was with Leicester. We were in Europe. We played at Atletico Madrid. We were coming back, and someone had got in touch and said Robbie Elliott had broke his leg. And they needed a left back. So would I be interested? Because I'd got a lot of family up north, like in the northwest. And I went, well, yeah, but the Leicester actually know that you want me. And is it going to go through before anything's happening, you know? Because at the moment, Martin O'Neill had said to me, I brought Steve Guppy in. Steve Guppy was playing wing-back. They'd gone to three-back, and he was on a probably moving to the centre-back. And I'm like, I'm a left-back. I want to get up and down and score goals, even though I never did. It was in my head. So Martin O'Neill pulled me when we got back and said, they've accepted an offer. I can go and talk to Bolton. So off a tunnel, sat in a room with Colin, found out it was Reebok Stadium, Man United, my debut on the Saturday. So it was done. Done.
Excellent.
You know, let's be honest, it's not even an option, is it? You're playing one of the best teams at the time with the Beckhams, the Giggs, and it's crazy.
Well, we can't be mentioning.
How dare you? How dare you?
I don't think you know. You play with feathers, you get your ass tickled.
We can't be mentioning that name on here, Matt. I'm sorry. No, we're not having it, mate.
Oh, bless you.
Nod your name, that's it.
That's the
offer,
isn't it? Oh. I love that.
Excellent.
You know, it was the start of a good journey at the time. Wow, super Bobby Taylor.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, I'd love one of them blue shirts. You can't get them anywhere.
I must admit, yeah. I've got one that Goodney signed to me. Goodney Bergson signed one to me with I Love Your Wits when I left from Goodney. I've got an Akotcha one with everybody's signature on. And I've got my first one with Peter Beardsley and Super Bob and them on it.
Wow, brilliant.
But yeah, it's, there you go. The air's getting there now, you see.
Yeah.
Now I'm proper. I like these now. We're getting proper. Wow.
There's another one.
Not change, how many players you look from the first one to the next one that come and go?
Yeah,
it's unbelievable, isn't it?
The one thing I'd say is Bergson was wow. Jaskalainen was another consistent, stayed there a long time.
Yeah, you know, Son's not doing bad. Have you ever had any of your young lads playing against Crewe, against his lad?
Not. I've seen him on the TV because I watched EFL Quest, and he went out on loan, believe it or not, to a place, his son, called Loughborough Dynamos a couple of years ago. And we had a young 18-year-old out there, and he was playing in the same team as him at the time, when he was going out as a youngster. didn't see Tuesday at the games or anything, but yeah, he was out there getting work experience and playing against men's football then. But he's done great. Let's be fair, mm-hmm. Tuesday was on. So he's yeah,
picture. I was going to buy this one, believe it or not, and send them to you to get some signed for us, but we want £475 for that, believe it or not.
Oh.
So I hope you're getting commission on all these pictures.
Oh golly, that fish legend. Yeah. Anna, he's close, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Peter Beardsley, that bloke was wow. It's mad. I've seen Neil Cox quite a bit. He's at Scunthorpe. He used to be at Notts County.
Is that Neil Cox, you say?
Neil Cox, Scunthorpe, now manager.
Yeah, he's Scunthorpe manager, yeah.
Yeah, he's settled them down a little bit now, but he was at Notts County for a little while as assistant.
Yeah, he signed one of our players on loan in beginning of the month, and apparently he's playing really well.
Yeah. Some golfer he is, by the way. Unbelievable at golf.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely unbelievable. So if you ever get him, don't worry about football. Talk about golf.
Right, I will.
He's an absolute legend at golf.
Oh, a lot of footballers seem to go into golf, don't they?
Well, my dad tried me when I was younger, and I used to think, this is rubbish. Why am I hitting this white thing all over the place? It never goes straight. And it's when I come to actual Bolton, and I lived in Lostock, and Dean was across the road, I used to go and hit some golf balls, and then I got into it. And I actually got down to, means probably nothing, handicap of like 8, which means I could actually hit it, and it didn't go wonky. So, but when I first played, I used to think, what a waste this is. I just whack a ball and go and look for it, because I couldn't, yeah. But yeah, I can see why people do it, because you can switch off. Go in at some golf ball, switch off and have a walk, I must admit.
Well, I think it's a good walk ruined, to be honest, golf.
Yeah. It's not so bad. If you go with your mates and have a chat, it's not so bad.
There's some legends in there, isn't there, mate?
Yes. Yeah, I was very fortunate. Nick Young, he's been playing forever, I think. I don't know if he's still going, Nicky.
Yeah, he's at Darlington. He had a really bad injury not long ago, head injury.
Yeah, he got stretched off, didn't he, big time?
Yeah, he only lives round the corner from us, Nicky. He has donated quite a bit of stuff to the group, Nicky. But yeah, he's up at Darlington at the minute. But yeah, it was pretty serious that injury he had.
He's had some years now. Because Nicky was an apprentice, same year as Kevin. I'm sure he's in around same age as Kevin Nolan, that era of apprentices.
Right.
But I remember Nicky being really, really young when I first went, as in an apprentice.
Mr. Nolan used to clean your boots, didn't he?
Ish, yeah. Yeah. No, he was... It is another young lad that just come into and broke into the first team and with the players around, and wow, what a career.
Oh, bless him. Yeah, we love him. He always seemed to score against them noisy buggers down the road, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we can't let him because that thing comes on it, but when it come on again, I'll say it, because that was quite funny.
We can mention them when we win.
Yeah.
No. I want to play you a bit of footage now and see what you remember about this game. I think the commentator mentioned it, but I'd just like to hear your thoughts and how it all come about.
And got us went to Tranmere and fueled suggestions of a feud between the clubs by arriving only 40 minutes before the start and leaving without even a shower. Mike Whitlow's goal gave Wanderers the points in a 1-0 win. Tranmere fullback Gareth.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I actually went to the ground because I was captain that day, and me and Phil Brown had to have the team sheet in an hour before kickoff. And Aldridge and Sam, they'd had a bit of a... They didn't get on, did they, let's be honest, at all?
No.
And so it was decided that we'd get changed at the ground, everybody, and they'd travel up on the bus, and the only two people that went up before the game was myself and Phil to hand the team sheet in. And so we went and handed the team sheet in, and all we did was what all the players come what straight off the bus, straight on the pitch, did the warm up, played the game straight off.
Yeah, you even had your showers back at well, it's had that many bloody names. It was called Reebok then, I think, weren't it?
Yeah. It's mad because this is like what we do nowadays, you know, with everything that's going on. You turn up in your kit, you play your game, you bugger off home and have your shower. All the kids now at the moment with the 18s and stuff, and I don't know how it happens with the bigger ones, but they're segregated now and they get changing rooms, and some are getting changed in bars. But for the 18s, it's like proper grassroots stuff again. It's brilliant.
Yeah. When they come to Bolton now, the away team get changed in the hotel. You know, the hotel on the away end, where I call it the away end. It's South Stand. But
we used the normal changing rooms. You know, before with Mansfield.
Yeah.
This was before it broke out the second time.
It's the second wave that's caused it. Yeah.
It's the second wave. They get changed in hotel now and coming through that tunnel at corner.
Yes.
So, do you remember these football cards that were out when you were playing?
Yeah, you don't see many sevens or eights, do you?
I love that picture.
Oh, brilliant.
He's a legend, I must admit. He's probably the hardest player, probably, when I was a centre-back, I'd played against.
Wow.
He could absolutely lose you in a split second because he was that intelligent. He'd wait for you to look that way and then he'd be gone. He'd just get a yard and he'd pass it off before, for me, I wanted to try and tackle him, but I couldn't because it had already gone.
Wow.
I just thought, wow. As in football intelligence and how he was, it was ridiculous. His movement could lose you in 2 yards.
He used to have a fear of, I remember we went over to, where were it? I think it was Germany for European Championships, and we were playing, and he wouldn't fly.
So he missed the game.
We went up somewhere with England and we stopped over for a fortnight, and he weren't playing. I thought, why is he not playing? He's got to be first name on team sheet, surely. And they said he won't fly.
Wow.
And it's 2-1 together, but I don't know where it were. Anyway, we're going to have a little break before we come on to Ipswich.
Oh, God, that's a good one. We need a break before that.
Yeah. Could
be a little on that one.
We can't swear, so...
No, we're not allowed.
What we generally do at this point is we have a bit of fun. So yeah. I'm going to hand you over to Twiggy in a minute, and we'll see what you're not. Here we go.
Right, Mike.
Be kind. Time. I could have got the one last week, Vitality Stadium. I'll have that one.
Yeah, Trevor, he struggled with that one, didn't he?
Oh, I wouldn't have got the ones that he got.
I'll tell you what, beforehand, though, I wish I'd known he knew that much about Indian football, because there was a lot of Indian questions, and he's got some knowledge over there, but Phil's, I didn't do my homework.
Yeah,
that's right.
Back there.
Mm. Yeah, Owen Coyle as well. He's over there as well. Mm. Yeah, right. Here we go. We'll soon know whether they're easy or not. They're easy to me because I have the answers.
Yeah.
Right. Question number one: which team used to play at the Goldstone Ground?
Brighton Hove Albion.
Yeah, spot on. Question number two: whose nickname is the Tractor Boys?
Ipswich.
Yeah.
Come on.
I was dreading how I mentioned the Ipswich thing then. I thought he's gonna say something.
There's a screen between us, yeah.
Right. As you played for Leeds, name two ex-Bolton players that have managed Leeds, and that can be either permanent or a caretaker. You've got to get two for one answer. 1 point, sorry.
Two players. Come on, mate. They've had loads of them lately, haven't they? Because they had a big turnover. No.
Yeah, they've had a few managers. No.
Don't forget the option. Twig it.
Yeah.
You've
got an option, Annie.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's my fault, Mike. I apologise. But you got the first two anyway. You can ask Al. There's one option of ask an admin. So as there's one on, you can ask Al if he...
Go on then, Al.
If you're stuck.
Come on, Al. Admin.
Manamana.
Peter Reid. Peter Reid. It's either Neil Redfern or Gary Megson. Oh, Peter Reid's definitely one.
Yeah.
It's up to you, mate. I mean, obviously, you've not got your choice. You can take Al.
I'll take Al. Reid and Megson, I'll go for.
Well, you've got to give you a point there. Peter Reid's one.
Yeah.
He said Megson. Who was the other one he said?
Redfern.
Neil Redfern.
Oh, yeah, so rubbish. Cheers, Al, anyway.
Sorry, Paul. That's all right.
Yeah, you're right. I think wrong one.
Good bit of knowledge there, Al.
Top man.
Right, question number four. He doesn't know the question, by the way, so I'm quite impressed there, to be honest. Right, question number four. What year did Bolton sign JJ Okocha?
2000. 99. Think which. Mm-hmm. 2001, 2000.
You did say it. No, 2002.
Oh!
You did say 2000. I thought you were going to get it when you said 2000. I thought you were going
to
get it.
I was trying to go back the years. I was just pretty sure he was coming in 2000. Did he turn up in 2002?
Yeah. But all these questions, you were obviously at Bolton this era, so the...
Oh, I've got no chance then. I'll stick with me 3 points that I've got.
Right, question number five.
Yeah.
Which North American side did Sam Allardyce play for in 1983? I kind of got the theme there, as Allardyce mentioned it while he was a manager, sort of thing.
Yeah, man. No, I seriously haven't got Scoobies.
No?
I haven't even got Cadman anymore, have I?
No, we don't have a few admins on, but yeah, we decided just to give 50, you one 50. Question. No, you've used it already. I've not even got two answers to give you. But the answer is the Tampa Bay Rowdies.
I'd have never got that, Twiggy. No, not a chance.
Yeah, I just thought in case you might have mentioned it one season, it stuck in your mind.
No.
Right, question number six. Yoshiyasuke Lion was sent off in a league game in 2001. What team was it against?
I'll get me coat. I might as well multi-guess here. Middlesbrough.
No, Newcastle.
Ooh, right area, yeah. Wrong colour.
Yeah. I thought, and you played in that game as well, so I thought you might have got that.
I can't remember yesterday, Twiggy. We're on Saturday, it was Friday yesterday, that's it.
Right, in season 2000-2001, Bo Anson was given the number 9 shirt, having worn number 14 the season before. Name the striker that vacated the number 9 shirt at the end of 99 and 2000.
Ulswith always had 10. Ida didn't have it then. Oh, come on. How far back am I going now? Because that's like Super Bob, Super Bobby Taylor's era. Was it? Oh, God. Because you've got Blake, then you've got Taylor. I'm going to go for Super Bobby Taylor.
Yes, but on. Yeah, it was.
Come on.
Taylor. Yeah.
I thought you
were going to pick someone else then when you said Super Bobby.
It was Blakey as well, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
In
so,
and around that time when he left.
Yeah. Bob Taylor, yeah, cracker. When he scored that goal against United, brilliant. Super Bob. Right, question number 8. You played alongside Per Franssen at Bolton. In his 2 spells at Bolton, how many appearances did he make?
God.
You got to 5 either way.
Oh, golly. He hardly missed a game. Go for...
Because I think we sold him to Blackburn, didn't we?
Yeah.
That's when Colin Todd resigned, weren't it?
Yeah.
And then he came back.
And then he come back. So he's probably got 4 seasons and he's probably 40 games. I go for 150.
271.
Oh, my God!
Yeah.
I was shooting. God.
Yeah, so they give you. I thought we were being a bit tight, giving you 5 either way, but you was.
I know, you could have given me 100.
You're 120, are you?
I know. Oh my God.
Right, you were doing well as well. You've only got 3. I thought you were on for a good run when you first got the first 2.
No,
right.
It's never going to happen.
Question number nine. Bolton signed Ida Goodjohnson in 1998. Which Midlands club did he make his debut against?
I remember his wonder goal, because that's a memory I'll never forget against Wimbledon when he went to past 6 players. That bloke, he come as a fat kid when he was with us on tour in Denmark. And I thought, wow, right. Who's this kid? And then it took him 3 months and then he was ridiculous.
Did he have he had an ankle injury, didn't he? And
that's why he put a lot of weight on and stuff, because he got told he won't be able to play again with his ankle injury. Yeah. And wow, what a career.
Big Sam gave him a lifeline.
Let's go back to the question.
Yeah, Midlands club.
Because could be Derby, could be Forest, could be Derby. Why not?
No, Birmingham. Home win again. We won 3-1. Home win.
At least they got the right place anyway, round in about. I'm in the middle.
Right. Right. Hey, you're bottom of the league at the minute.
Believe me, that's decent.
Right. Now, this is a bit of a stinker, this one, I think. But
cheers.
When you were at Leeds United,
yes.
Which former Bolton player came to your house and sold you a house alarm?
Oh, you...
Obviously, I wouldn't know this, but I've been given this...
When I was at Leeds, a Bolton player come to my house in Leeds and sold me a house alarm.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Come on, think. It would have been over that way. Bolton player. It's not Target. I'm just trying to think who was in and around there. Brannigan would turn into music and a teacher.
Your house was in Morley. That's a clue.
Yeah. I can remember where it was. A White House, neighbours next door, lovely. See if I had a chippy up the main road. Can remember that much. Come on, Wits. Bolton, that era. No. I'm going to have to... John McClellan. No. John McGinley. No.
I'll
give up. Go on.
Gary Henshaw.
Oh, my
Gary
Henshaw. God.
And he sent me the question to ask you. So that he said you didn't think you'd get it, but
not a chance.
Yes. Yeah.
When
so
you said I can remember, but not hadn't a clue who.
Yeah. So I thought
forward, dark hair.
Yeah. Well, I thought I'd throw that in anyway. So that's off Gary Henshaw. That
anyway, I'm bottom, so I'm doing well.
Yeah. So unfortunately, the total you got 3 out of 10. But hey, it's all a good bit of fun. But you are bottom of the league so far. Well, I'll let you back to Aldo then.
Cheers, bud.
Excellent.
Well, I'll tell you what, that's Dave Fellgate. He watches them every week, does Dave? He rang me the other day and he said, oh, please make the questions heard for Mike, he said.
I'll tell you what.
He said, please make the questions heard for Mike.
No chance. He's a rotter. Twiggy's a rotter. Yeah.
Gary Henshaw, we've actually invited 4 players this week to be ambassadors of our charity. And Mark Kame's one of them, absolute legend, Mark. Mm. Fantastic fella. Gary Henshaw's another. Gary does all the commentaries now on all our own games. He does a fantastic job. Yeah, he does a brilliant job. Yeah, and he's a great supporter group. Jeff Chandler and John Thomas.
He was a wizard. He was a wizard on the wing. So we used to train at the dog track. Remember the ground track near Burnham Park?
Oh, yeah.
And they let's just say, you know, when they go through football initiations, that era, that's when we had to stand on tables and sing to them all and everything when they were pros.
Oh,
and then you get jet washed.
Kamey would have loved the singing. I mean, he did an Elvis impression for us on his stream.
he had a good time, bless him.
They're all good blokes. All down to earth, 100% as good blokes. Yeah. Right, well, let's get some questions. Twiggy, have you got a question?
Yeah, well, I've got a few, actually, but I'll... obviously, we've picked up on the... when Graeme Souness labelled you a cheat. That is dummy out, but that's what they do at Blackburn anyway, don't they? After that, did your pats ever cross? And did he ever mention it if he did?
To be fair, once I think it went on for about a week where Sam actually sent the papers, the actual picture of I'd got a 6-inch gash that needed stitches down the side of my shin. Did I deserve it, if I'm being honest? Probably.
Well, yeah, I mean,
kicked him again, and we were backing at each other and having everything. And he did catch me. Did it hurt as much as?
I kind of remember that era. But I mean, all I remember is Souness spitting his dummy out.
Oh, he went mad! And to be fair to Big Sammy, he said, "Listen, I'll send you the pictures," and said to the reporter straight after the game, "Listen. The kid might be all right, and maybe he wasn't as bad as what he was making out at the time, but he's got a 6-inch gash and he's actually had stitches in it down the front of his carp where he'd stamped on him."
Definitely.
But you know, it's shit paper, innit?
He was a bad tempered man, that Souness. I remember Margaret telling me at ticket office when we actually drew with him and he smashed all to cups and saucers and pot and everything through
the crazy thing is, in that era, it's on staff when if they were passionate and they'd come for you and rah, 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 and teacups went and all that, so what, it didn't matter. It sounds crazy. It's players then, it sounds crazy, we're a little bit more let them lose you for 10 minutes and then we'll crack up next week.
So a loser, definitely.
Yeah.
There's another one I've got to ask. I used to work at Vauxhall, you know, up the road, the dealer.
Yes.
Up the road from Burnham Park. Do you remember a mechanic shouting to you to sign a fixture list in his toolbox?
Oh God, no. Honest.
Well, that mechanic was me.
Oh, I mean, how old were you?
Oh God, I'm 50 now, so God, but 30. Yeah. No, about 20, 27, something like that.
Wow.
Yeah, no, yeah, around about 90. No, hang on. Yeah, 1970, something like that. But I seen you across the cut. So somebody had said Mike Whitlow's in because they knew you were a Bolton supporter. Yeah. So I was on the where Vauxhall was on the front bays.
Yeah.
So I was waiting for you coming out, and you were going across the car park. They shout anyway. You signed me fixture list on my toolbox, and I've still well. I thought
Yeah.
So, but I got all my tools nicked, and that fixture list was in it. So otherwise, I'd have kept that fixture list and showed it you.
Bless you.
Just right. One more question I've got. As you said, your dad was a goalkeeper, and you started off as a goalie. Or yeah. You wanted to be a goalie. Did you ever go into goal in a game? Do you know, say like the goalie sent off or was there ever an opportunity? No. Because like McGinley went in goal against Reading, so yeah, I just thought with the goalkeeper theme where you'd never been asked.
No, I think that in training now and again, you know, when you're having kick-ins and stuff, I'd be quite happy to put gloves on and go and dive around and think I'm a cat. The old man said I was too much of a poser with diving and everything, instead of just catching it, that had never been any good anyway.
All right. So, yeah, I thought I'd just throw that in with the goalkeeper theme.
No, I've never got the opportunity.
All right.
Right, we've got quite a few questions on Facebook for you. First one's off a guy you used to play with. His dad were a legend at our place, David Kame. He says, hi, mate. When you speak to Mike, can you ask him every time I used to phone him why his wife used to call me Batman?
Oh, God. There's a reason I've got an answer. If you'd have asked this 20 years ago, I'd have probably remembered. But there must have been a reason that this was happening. But Warwick, if I'm being honest, I couldn't recall it, but he'll know. Go on, fill me in.
I've no idea, but if he's watching it,
yeah.
Hopefully you'll put a comment in the Facebook with the answer. If not, I shall ask Mark to ask him, and I'll message you or I'll let you know next time we speak. Good mate of mine, Juan, Halifax White, he absolutely he loves you, basically. You're one of his favourite players. He just said, can you thank Mike for me? He was integral to getting us back up there. Playoffs, cups, semi-finals, early Prem days. Always gave 100%, whether at left back or centre back. Too underrated for his massive contribution to the Whites. A really friendly bloke.
That's kind. It's always, it's always nice, Al, and I said this to you when we spoke last week. I just love playing football, and when I went out there, I knew I was never going to look at a programme and say Silky's skilled and technically gifted. I just wanted to keep a shirt. It sounds crazy. In my head, when I got that shirt, I wanted to keep that shirt and play every week. And if I had a stinker, which I probably did in some games, it was an honest stinker. If I made a mistake, it was an honest mistake. And I've got some, as I said, I've got some very fond memories of sitting in a changing room with a group of internationals and a Sunday league player. It's crazy.
Well, you weren't out of place in our eyes, mate. I can assure you that. Peter Whitehead says, pure legend, especially when he scored that winning goal at Trashmere. A rare win for the Whites when a certain Mr. Riley refereed. That's that one. And we got some live. It says, Mike, thanks a million for all your efforts at Bolton. You always gave 110% and a quality, good, solid fullback.
Yeah. Checking that one, definitely.
I got one from a youngster here, Kelby King Making, one of our admins, good lad. He says, Mike comes across as a lovely bloke. Was expecting him to be cutthroat.
This is mad, Al. Because he knows daft as a brush. I really am daft as a brush.
Plenty of one here saying, legend, what a player. Another one says, unsung hero, what a bloke, absolute legend. And then another one says, in your career, which three players stood out to him as special? Wow, there's that many, isn't there?
Ricard, in my team or against?
No, in your career. In your career, which three players stood out to you to being special?
At the very, very early start of Leeds, I went to Tottenham and had to man Mark Gascoigne. And I got absolutely rinsed. Never got near him. He put me centre midfield, Howard, because he knew I could run to mark him. Never got near him. Unbelievable. Wow. He was unbelievable. We spoke about Dennis Bergkamp.
What was that, sorry?
Dennis Bergkamp.
He
mugged me off every time we played him. I couldn't get near him. And I got sent off playing for Leicester, Anfield, McManaman. Steve McManaman, absolutely. He was in that era with the Spice Boys, as they call them, and the Fowler. And it was that era. And honestly, I kicked him twice. I probably tried about another 50 times, but couldn't get near him. His feet were magnificent. Credit. And he was only slight as well. He wasn't one of these big beefers. Yeah. But yeah, I don't really think back of all these years and who. You think, there's been some decent ones. The Van Nistroys and we had Cantona played against us on the one where I managed to toe-poke it in. Mark Hughes was immense. I said to you before, Shearer, he was... We played, I think it was Bolton. I'm sure we were there with Bolton to St. James's Park and got beat 4-3. And we were winning. And they equalised. And we scored. And then they got another.
I remember, because we was, because Bolton fans were that high up in the sky.
Yeah, right in the clouds.
Yeah, I remember that. Because I had to phone my missus up to see which Bolton player had scored. Yeah, it was. You're right. Yeah, I was at that game. But the blonde-haired player who played for Bolton and scored, I can't think of his name now. I can't. I'd have to look. But yeah, it was that
Freddie Bobbitt. Yeah. We had Freddie as well, didn't we?
Freddie.
He was brilliant.
Yeah, he was brilliant. And
Stick-tofted. Wow.
I tell you what, just while a question I was going to put in last night when I were doing the questions, Freddie Bobbitt.
Yeah,
he played for Germany, international for Germany. But where was he born? What was his nationality? Like, birth nationality?
Yugoslavia. I didn't.
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Oh, I put it in there. I was debating.
You didn't ask that one, did you?
Right. Question off. Yeah. Best manager you played under?
They've all been great with me because I've got on well with them all. But I think because that was the most settled had been and comfortable, and it was crazy. Yeah, with Martin when he suggested that at Leicester, I was crazy that it may seem a lot better than the look playing in there.
I think your connection's breaking up there, Mike.
Yeah.
Who did you say then, Mike? Your connection were breaking up. Was it Martin O'Neill?
No, I said Big Sam.
Right.
Because when I was at the time, because I'd got a bit older and appreciated, sounds crazy, football a hell of a lot more in each game as you get a little bit older. Sam had moved me from left back to centre back. And when I went to centre back, I had the best time ever. I loved it. And Bergson playing Bergson, Jasker line and behind. It used to be Franson or Paul Warrest in front. And then a Kotcha come and York, and you think, oh my God. And I used to just watch all this going on. Or I was picking ball out of the net if we got beat by one of these bigger teams, bless them.
Yeah.
But it was spot on.
Wow. Yeah. And another one here. Who's been your biggest influence in life?
Is it football or life?
Life.
Dad. Dad.
I absolutely knew you'd say that. Fair play.
Million miles of dad. One.
Right. Let's go back to the old footballer.
Yeah. Jimmy Floyd.
Oh, yeah. Actually, it's a guy who you used to work alongside, that, isn't it?
Yeah, when I took over, I became Bolton's. Burton asked me to set up their academy 11 years ago nearly now. So I went in, and at the time it was Paul Pesky Salido. So Ben Robinson and Fleur sat down in a room with Paul, said, listen, we're looking at setting an academy up, 9s to 18s. How do we go about it, blah, blah, blah. Would like it done in 3 months. So I should have got my camp bed out and camped there for 3 months. But, yeah, I accepted the job, started setting up the academy. Paul, unfortunately, got sacked. Gary Rowett come in. And then Gary moved on to Birmingham, I think it was. And, yeah, Jimmy Floyd's first job. And he got them up and promotion. So, and he's now actually just gone back there.
Yeah, I was just going to say he's gone back, hasn't he? Yeah.
Yeah, devil for punishment.
Right, everybody's itching for this. And I suppose this is, I suppose, I mean, you give us loads of great memories, but this one, I've had so many questions on this one. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to play a few highlights and then we'll go through it. Here we go.
Wide opening. Johansson's cross, a real test for Richard Wright. And the goalkeeper stumbled. The goal has been allowed to stand. Richard Wright felt then that he'd been. Magilton trying to give Ipswich some inspiration. Magilton again. Penalty. Never any doubt in the referee's mind. But confrontation now, because Mike Whitlow felt there that Jim Magilton had taken a dive. It's a high-octane occasion. And now, Barry Knight, the referee, really has to take charge. Jensen's there. So too is Warhurst. It's Holdsworth. Is there another? Terrific free kick. Richard Wright thought he got all the angles covered. But a superbly worked free kick has given Bolton Wanderers the lead again. Fantastic save by the Bolton Wanderers goalkeeper. Ipswich haven't got a particularly good record from the penalty spot. But Magilton decided to go with his first instincts to put it into the same corner that he put the first one in. Jaskalainen guessed right. What a crucial save that could prove. Now there's danger signs here. And Bolton Wanderers are back in front. It's Johnston. The ball was launched upfield from that Bolton Wanderers free kick. Jaskalainen, and it was who pumped it forward, and it was just chested down there by Holdsworth into Johnston's path. There's Naylor. Now Stewart. Marcus Stewart fouled then. Mike Whitlow it was who brought Stewart down. Whitlow is involved in an unpleasant incident with Jim Magilton. Has been sent off. He can't believe it. He spoke out in the first half, but he wasn't cautioned. And that was a straight red for Mike Whitlow. We're now into the fourth.
What a load of sheep's danglers that was. That sending off.
Yeah. Straight red, unbelievable.
It was, we come in at half time and Sam's going mad, and Jimmy Phillips and Phil, and he's gone round and he says, right, whatever you do, this is, he's having one. Whatever's happening, referee's having one, so be careful. Who's not been booked? So me and Robbie Elliott, yeah, we have them. We were the two that got sent off. Me and Robbie Elliott. Madness, honest. I think we'd come away with 13 bookings.
Yeah, suck of
the top. I remember the game, the penalties and the thing, and it sticks to this day because I thought, this isn't right, because he's caught me as I fell on him.
Yeah.
I didn't actually kick him, but...
No, you didn't. You just rolled in as you felt. It was just momentum into him.
I must admit, I didn't help myself, did I, with the first one, because I lost my head because I thought he dived. And I'm going at the ref and telling him not very nicely that I don't think it's a penalty. In them words, and he didn't agree with me.
But how can that be a straight red? It's unbelievable, isn't it?
You know, like... Yeah, and the crazy thing is, was you look and you think, even nowadays with this VAR, that's not even close to getting a booking.
No.
But I remember him, Paul Warris went down halfway through the game and with the groin, and our physio got booked for trying to get on the field to him because he'd been down for ages because he didn't stop play.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
About 10 minutes later, Barry Knight's walking big Scowcroft off the field with his arm around him when he's injured. And he's thinking,
yeah, definitely something for that match. Definitely.
But at the end of the day, he conceded the goals, would have won the game. And wow, if you look back at the game, you think, what a game. It's horrible to lose, horrible.
Yeah.
But for a neutral watching that, it had everything. It's crazy.
Yeah, it did. Yeah.
Goals. And let's be fair, Magilton was decent. You know, don't like saying it, but he was.
Yeah.
So at the time, yeah, it's one that always sticks that you think, I don't like this referee even to this day very much.
Yeah, I don't. He never refereed another game again. He was going to do an Aston Villa game, and then he got taken off. On advice. So.
Yeah.
But that night at Ipswich, what a terrible journey home that was.
I know, I was on the bus.
It brought it all that particular night.
Sometimes that, you know, when they say to you that circumstances, however much you try, and you try your best, and you know, all with scores and Allen and that, and you're thinking we've got a chance here, and you don't, you think doesn't matter what, it wasn't going to be.
Yeah.
And it's horrible, but you know, them lads on that pitch that night give everything they've got.
Do you know what? On the way back, it brought it all into perspective to me that it wasn't about football that night. On the way back, getting on for midnight actually, and we're just driving over Saddleworth, and where it goes down in that big dip. And there was a car on its roof, and we just slowly went past and went. And it turned out the day after that it was a Bolton bloke and his son, and they both lost their lives. So that's I know that's my biggest memory of that game, to be honest with you. I know it sounds a bit sad, but one more question, and this is the last question, I promise.
All right.
He says, "Do you remember getting on the coach after the game at Ipswich?"
The biggest memory I've got for Ipswich was when we were coming in and Jimmy Phillips tried to kick the referee's door in and was going mad after the game. apart from that, that's probably getting sent off to that, all going off after the game. Not really. It was just sort of, get on the bus, let's bugger off.
Yeah. You know, the way you come across, as a bloke, you're just like so down to earth and such a nice fella. And what a lot of people don't know about you when you play for Bolton Wanderers is your daughter went through an absolutely terrible time. And I hope you don't mind me bringing it up, but you had it rough. You had it rough, mate, didn't you?
Well, to be fair to her and the club and everybody concerned in the community, Croft House, where she was at the nursery, she got rushed in with meningitis septicemia. She was completely shut down, and we thought we'd lost her, And she was only a dot. Well, she was a baby, and the support that we got there and everything in and around it from, and it sounds crazy, the football community, because the Leeds people that I'd been with and the players and the staff there and Leicester and then Bolton were brilliant with us because, yeah, sometimes it sounds crazy. It's football's the best thing in the world and we go mad when we lose and things like that. But there's bigger things happening in the world and in and around us that is real life, innit? And that affects a hell of a lot. And yeah, it was great that everybody pulled together and in the community and wanted to help us. So yeah, ever so grateful. And bless her, she's 23 now and yeah, she's not allowed to have boyfriends even though she has.
Absolutely
brilliant, bless her.
Excellent.
That's absolutely brilliant to hear. Another thing that I forgot to mention before is you played all your career without a spleen, didn't you?
Yeah, I was never blessed with brains when I was little. And when myself and my sister decided to play hide and seek, they used to be like, be careful, mum and dad would say be careful. So I'm hiding behind a glass cabinet. So it's all glass shelves with a cardboard back. So I'm hiding behind, she's seen me. So me having the brains of an absolute idiot, I'm thinking I'm going over it because it's quicker. So I can get to the place where she can't say she's got me. So as I've gone over it, instead of going over it, I've actually gone through it. And my mum was with two ladies downstairs, and I'll never forget the bloke's name, Mr. Gallimore. He lived at the top of the street. Mum will always never forgot this. He come wrap me up in a bed sheet, put my guts back in and rushed me off to hospital. And yeah, I had my spleen removed and yeah, I've been on penicillin all my life since.
Well, I personally, and I'm sure all the lads on the group, we still think a lot of you in this town. You wore the shirt. And as the saying goes, once you play for us, and we only take to certain players, you're one of our own and you always will be. You're always welcome at our town, to any of our events. We welcome you with open arms, mate. We will, because you're an absolutely lovely bloke. So let's move on to your management and coaching. You say, you went to Burton, didn't you?
Yeah, I took over the academy, and then yeah, as we say, Gary decided up sticks. So the manager said, "Listen, will you look after them for me? I need you to look after first team until I can get someone in." This was 7, 8 years ago now. And I said, yeah, not a problem, as long as it's not too long, because I don't want to do it. You know, I've always said that. And I don't mind the coaching and looking after them. But we had Plymouth coming up on the Saturday. So I had a week of training with the first team. We drew 1-1. So EFL management career is still a draw. So that was good. And then we were meant to play Barnsley. Well, we did play Barnsley on the Saturday, but my dad got rushed in. This was when I lost dad at roundabout. And dad got rushed in. And so I was back and to the hospital, as well as people helping take the team. And then Ben Robinson said to me, bless me, listen, these are the candidates. What are your thoughts? What would, you know me and the club, what would be a good fit? And yeah, we played Barnsley. I got a phone call halfway through the Barnsley game, to be fair, if I'm being honest. It was the FA Cup. We're walking off at half-time. Lee Bell, centre mid, said, sorry, Wits, I'm having a shift to take me off. Funniest thing I've ever seen in football, because I was going to anyway, but he had actually... it was my captain, because he'd just given two goals away and we were 2-0 down, and 44 minutes, we were 0-0. And at half-time, I got the dreaded phone call. I must admit that he wasn't really well. And so after that game, that was the end of Jimmy coming on the Monday. I lost dad. I had a right good chat with dad. And yeah, my life sort of ventured a different direction then, because dad had had a really good chat and said, listen, son, you're doing 7 in the morning till 11 at night. You've not had an holiday 6 years. You're obsessed with football. Don't forget, your kids are growing up quick. Mum will need you a little bit more when I'm not here. And, proud of what you've done. I can honestly say, I said, listen, the day you go pop, I'll resign. And the day you went, the day after, I sent the letter in. And it was something that I'd stuck to, because if I stayed at Burton and your name's over the door of setting something up, you can't leave it and switch off, if that makes sense, because you want everything it can be. And so I come away, went to the Euros in England, in France. I got a phone call over there saying, Mansfield, I've got a under-21s job. Would I be interested? And I took that on. And now I do the 18s. But it's days and Sundays, up until the COVID thing, is, yeah, go see my mum. And really? I do nights. You know, I'll get in at 4, 5, 6 o'clock at night. Phone will be aside for an hour and let's take the dog.
Yeah. Oh. God bless you, Dad, and I hope he's sleeping tight. And I'm telling you what, mate, he'll be well proud of you, mate. I'm telling you that.
Definitely.
And you came to Bolton, didn't you, as a manager?
Yeah. Yeah.
I remember that.
You swine.
Actually, Cumran was set up and with what's Bolton for ages. And they kept playing a three in midfield and a three in midfield with the ones up front. And we're thinking, we're all right with this. We were happy because we were going 4-3-3 and we were thinking, yeah. We turned up, he went with a box four, didn't he? So, and we'd changed our three to a diamond with Nicky Mayer in behind, thinking we'd get Nicky in the space. And then Everett went 2-2. So I'm like, this is not good. Because for the first 20 minutes, it was, yeah. I don't think we got a kick, did we, for about 20 minutes, Mansfield?
No.
And then we settled into it and got in front, and then we're thinking, hold on, but I've got to admit, if we'd have beaten them, my lad had never spoken to me again. my youngest lad, Bolton man, absolute. And so after the game, he's come in, he went, that's a good one for both of us, Dad. And
yeah.
But it's, I've done it. I helped Richard Cooper, and It's not something I've ever wanted to stay and do. You know, an odd game here, that's fine. We went to Sunderland and got Mansfield's first win of the season against Sunderland in the FA Cup, which, if we're being honest, it was grab a goal, right, let's sit on the edge of our box and don't forever let them score. And it was bad. You know, you want these lads and the George Lapses and people that have just started their careers that have come through from Charlton now at Mansfield, you want them to have experiences that they're going to enjoy, because they're young professionals.
Yeah.
And there's what you've already achieved, and fair play to you.
Yeah, to be fair to the boys, you know, Josh, there's a lad on there that's now earned himself a professional contract. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them that are still with us there, that are now, they were first year scholars there. They're now second year scholars that they're hoping to earn a professional contract. We've got another 8, 9 we took this year. We, the first time that Mansfield have had a Cat 3 academy, which is 9s to 16s, because Mansfield's always been from 16 to 18. So, you know, to be fair to the club, they're investing to try and get a crop of younger players all the way through to try and play for the first team. And fingers and toes crossed that I'll probably be done, dusted, and walking my dog with my stick, you know, when a 9-year-old comes through in another 7 or 8 years. But I hope, you know, that it keeps going that way, because when you see a kid enjoying themselves playing football, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
I actually got a question and I can't find it, but it related to a young kid who was... He were playing when Yoski were there and El Abzi and what's the other guy called, Twiggy? I think they got him from Leicester, the other goalkeeper.
Oh, Matt.
I can't remember his name. It's just
Walker.
Walker, that's it, yeah. And he said he was playing for the reserves, and he said, Mike Whitlow, he said he was absolutely brilliant with me. He brought all my confidence out, and he said he was a massive influence on me. And I can't remember his name. I think it was 6 hours, something like that.
The biggest
Chris
thing
Howarth,
is,
yeah, Chris Howarth, he was a young goalkeeper when you were there, and you kept putting your arms around him and cheering up. Do you remember him?
Bless him. That is a long time ago. But yeah. The one thing I'd say was, it's like anything. People don't forget. And if you can help them, because they're all not going to make it, and you take a little bit of time to get to know them, and you try and help them and guide them. People have done that for me all the way through my career. Colin Henry stay out when I was a player and help me to intercept balls and read the game better. Because if you remember, they brought the rule in, can't tackle from behind.
Yeah, yeah.
So that season, I went 5 games, 5 bookings. So we decided that, dopey idea, you can't do what you were doing. Because if you keep doing it, you're never going to play football. And bless Colin, we went through the videos, and bless Colin Henry, he'd stayed behind with some of the kids and showing me how to not smash people, in other words, and always want to win the ball. Sometimes showing them that the same way, you've done a really good job. And these are the things that I'll never forget. Noel Blake at Leeds, that used to look after me like his son, the big centre half, you know, 6 foot, built like a wall.
Yeah. Now, I'll tell you what you won't forget, and I think this is one of your biggest highlights, was when the likes of Okocha, Engog, all them players awarded you players player of the year.
Oh, yeah, Jesus, let's be honest. Sunday league striker to playing a career to sitting in a changing room and thinking, wow. Listen, fond memories, Ricardo Gardner, you know, France, and you can just keep going. You can keep on going. Yeah. And for me to get that off them was the biggest thing that will always stick in my brain because, yeah, let's be fair, they're internationals and legends. Campo, Jesus, he could put it on a sixpence from 50 yards. Bruno Nogossi, oh my God, what was he about? What a player.
Yeah.
And you can go through them all. And I used to sit there sometimes and I say to the lads now, for somebody that they trusted and knew that they'd give everything, that's probably what got it me. It wasn't, you know, fucking over people's heads and going round them and all that. It was probably because he trusted me. Bergson, Gundy Bergson, you know. You can go through it, France and Klaus Jensen, and it's madness when I look at the opportunity that football and my journey that sent me on, that I came across these players. Yuri Djorkaeff won the World Cup. What's that about? What am I doing in the changing room with the captain of the World Cup winning team?
Yeah.
And I appreciate it. And I still, to this day, I've loved every minute of it because, you know, each manager's gave me an opportunity to fulfill a dream. And it's lovely memories, lovely memories.
Superb. And he is your best mate. He's your best mate.
Yeah, you're not
wrong. Saying, don't
he? Yeah. The trouble is she's half me tea. And every time we take a vet, I get told she's too fat. I must admit, this is now, you know, bless her, we go out and you can switch off. I've never known, if I'm being honest, how to. And then at night now, I can actually, for the first time, you know, maybe it's because I'm a bit more mature and older and not as crazy mad hyperactive as it used to be, but, you know, switch off, get the dog, get out on the field, take her for a little walk and not get bothered.
Yeah.
You know, just switch the brain off from everything, because sometimes it's nice to have a bit of space. And when you're coming through the door every day, I guarantee you smile.
Yeah.
Because she never has a bad day.
What's her name?
Lucy.
Lucy.
And she's a puggle. But she's more round than she is beagle. She's definitely got more pug in her. So that's what I tell the vet. She's more pug than she is beagle. Cheers, Bob.
Brilliant.
Cheers, Bob.
Well, Mike, all I can say is it's been an honour and a privilege. So I'm not going to call it an interview because it's been like talking to a mate. And we'd like to thank you for all the memories you gave us. All the lads have I mean, there's that many comments. Top player, 100% a legend. You've heard them all. So, Mike, thank you very much. Wish you all the best for the future. And while you're in our league, I hope you only lose two games a week, two games a season.
<mate. Bugger off. laughs> You're a star, Al Twiggy. It's been an absolute pleasure. You know where I am if you need me for help. Seriously, fellas.
God bless you, man.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mike. Superb. You're a gent. True gent.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Twiggy, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Yeah, as I say, I want to thank Mike again for his time. It's been absolutely superb. And as you say, Al, it's like talking to one of the lads. And it just shows how down to earth, Mike, you really are. So, again, it's an absolute honour and a privilege to have you on. so, yeah, and I'm sure there's a lot more Bolton fans that, you know, decide was and say thank you very much for your time. You've given great pleasure tonight. Next week's stream, we've got Robbie Savage on. So tune into that. That'll be another interesting one. So, again, thanks, everybody. Thanks, Mike. And you're back to Al now. Stay safe. All the best.
All right.
Stay safe. Nice. Bye-bye, Mike.
God bless you.
Okay. See you, Mike.
Also, see you, buddy.
See you, Mike. All the best, mate.
Bye-bye.
I'd also like to thank the sponsor, Oscar Recruitment. As Twiggy said, a fantastic company. Look them up on the website. It's at the bottom there. We've got a 100 draw going at the moment. There's 10 prizes, and one of them is a signed McGinley shirt in a frame, COA. That's on all the groups. There's only a few numbers left, but if you want to have a go, then pop over and do that. And please don't forget to have a vote in the poll that Twiggy's put up and let us know what suits. And if you'd like to actually come on one of these streams and join us and ask a few questions yourself. And if any of the sponsors want to come on, then they can come on as well. And don't forget, if you go on our YouTube channel and you're watching a recording of this, please like and subscribe. I nearly said that right then, Twiggy, didn't I? And because it helps the charity and helps us to help our own. So hopefully, if you're enjoying the streams, leave a comment. Thanks for listening to us. And thanks to Twiggy for doing a superb job as per usual. Aggie, we're thinking about you. Out your knee, pal. Give us a shout. God bless you. Good night. God bless. Thank you, everybody.
Good night. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish of a year, but you're not, 'cause the drinks bring back all the